Welcome to SystemVue, Introduction to Fixed-Point FIR Design. This video is part two of a two-part video. The part A of this video was Introduction to Digital Filter Design using SystemVue. In part two, this video, we will show how to convert a floating-point FIR filter into a fixed-point FIR filter and how to use the digital filter graphical user interface of SystemVue to design fixed point digital filters and optimize tap word lengths for a given performance metric, and then use that fixed point FIR filter model in a subsequent simulation and also export that model to VHDL using SystemVue's HDL code generator, and then finally verify the performance of that fixed point FIR filter code using the co-simulation interface between SystemVue and Mentor's ModelSim simulator. So let us pick up where we left off in the Introduction to Digital Filter Design video and take the floating point low pass FIR filter that was created in that video tutorial and convert that FIR filter to a fixed point FIR filter, and then port that fixed point bit true FIR filter to our HDL code generator to generate fully synthesizable VHDL that can then be used in a FPGA or ASIC design flow. So to start, I will take the FIR filter and I will right mouse click and open up the Filter Designer UI. And here we can see the same low pass response and impulse response that was created using the Introduction to Digital Filter Design tutorial. I'm going to keep all of the design parameters the same and simply change the data type from floating point to fixed point. Once I do that, you can see a new UI appear, or a new set of parameters appear in the Filter Designer UI that allow me to control the word length of the tap coefficients in my FIR filter, and also control the numeric quantization and overflow handling for that filter design. The fixed point filter is a bit true fixed point filter that is modeled in 2's complement fixed point arithmetic. So hence I have control over both the fractional word length and the integer word length for that sine 2's complement model. So as I change the word length parameter here, you can see the response change accordingly. And here I can optimize manually the number of bits that I might want to assign to this filter to trade off the area that this filter will take up inside an FPGA or an ASIC with the desired response type. And as you can see, as I limit the number of bits to the tap coefficient word length, fractional word length, the frequency response changes. The passband response actually looks fairly well behaved, but the out of band rejection is violating our original design criteria of 50 dB. So I need to add some more bits to the design. And it looks like 14 bits may be a good compromise. Actually, that's looking quite good. Let's maybe go to 12 bits. And 12 bits is a good compromise where I have a slight degradation in my out-of-band rejection for this FIR filter, but have limited the number of bits to save area in the design. So now that I've adjusted the word length, I'm actually finished with the conversion process to convert the floating point design to a fixed point design. And I simply need to close the Filter Designer UI. And you can now see that the symbol for the FIR filter has changed from a blue arrowed symbol, which represents a floating point model, to a magenta arrowed symbol, which represents a fixed point model. Now, in order to simulate this model, I do need to modify my schematic just a little bit. I need to first modify my input to convert my floating point number to fixed point, and this is needed to do the numeric conversion correctly for HDL code generation. So I need to switch from my algorithm library to my hardware design library. And in the hardware design library, I can type in float to fix, which, or FXP, which will bring me to the float to fixed point converter, and I can just take that and place that on my schematic. Now I will also note that if I keep the impulse response or impulse source level at the sample rate, which is what we did in the previous tutorial to generate an impulse response and a frequency response that was correct, this will force the filter to go into overflow. So I'm just going to go ahead and change that back to a unit impulse and select the numeric type here to be 32-bit to have the signal level match the data signal level in the FIR filter, which I'll show you in a second, and also make sure that the filter is set to be the data converter is set to be a signed 2's complement with a integer value of 2. I now also, to scale the filter appropriately so that the frequency response and impulse response match that of the floating point, I need to go back to my algorithm library and simply add a ideal gain block and insert that gain block at the output and set its value to the sample rate just so that my response matches. And that was 80 e to the 3, or 80 kilosample per second. Now I can go ahead and re-simulate this model, and you can see that the response has changed relative to the floating point model, but does reflect the response variation that we saw in the filter designer UI. So I now have a fixed point representation of that FIR filter, and I am now ready to port this design to HDL code. So there is an additional step that needs to be done on the schematic. The HDL code generator, which I will add in a second, allows the porting of subnetworks to HDL code generation. So I need to just simply turn my FIR filter model into a subnetwork, and I can do that by just selecting that model or any collection of models and select right mouse click and select convert to subnetwork. And I'm just going to type in a simple name, FXP_FIR. Click OK. And here you can see the new subnetwork model that was created with a port at the input and output. Just close that schematic. And you also can see on the workspace tree that a new model was added, which is representative of the subnetwork model. So I need to manually just delete this model and reinstantiate this new subnetwork. And if I push into this subnetwork, again, you will see the original FIR filter model. So now with the FIR filter encapsulated in a subnetwork, I can go to my workspace tree, add an HDL code generator, which is accessible from a right mouse click anywhere in the workspace tree. And I can open up the code generator. And here I make sure that the top level design is selected to the top level design that contains my filter. Then I select the subnetwork that I want, which is the subnetwork that I created. Add that to my HDL code generator panel. You could also change the output directory where the HDL files are written to by selecting the output directory dialog. And you could do that by unchecking the default directory. And I'm going to go ahead and change my working directory to a different working directory. So I'm just going to select my workspaces under my documents and select test. And then in the lower portion of the HDL code generator UI, I can select how the code generator behaves. So I can generate target agnostic HDL, or I can generate HDL for Xilinx FPGAs. And what that does is that opens up a new set of options to allow me to select the Xilinx Vertex family, the FPGA device, and the FPGA packaging options, so that I can go ahead and map the I/O of my HDL design to specific pins in a Xilinx FPGA, and also set the digital clock module inside a Xilinx FPGA to minimize the manual intervention between SystemVue and Xilinx tools. Using the Xilinx option, SystemVue will script Xilinx ISC completely behind the scenes and will generate the final bit file for manual download into the Xilinx FPGA. So for this example, I'm just going to generate HDL only, and you have the option of generating both VHDL and Verilog. I'm going to generate VHDL, and you have the option of generating test vectors for use in standalone HDL verification with tools like ModelSim. When we select test vector generation on, SystemVue will create a top-level VHDL wrapper for ModelSim along with test vector data at the input and output points of the subnetwork that was selected here. So with these basic options, I will go ahead and click Generate, and you can see the SystemVue simulation server pops up. It said generating HDL. The HDL code was now generated, and that code now exists on my file system in the directory listed. Now, one additional verification step that you can make is to run a simulation of the design, not with the fixed point model, but with the actual HDL code. With the HDL code generator, once the HDL code was successfully created, SystemVue also created a new model that is associated with the subnetwork that allows this simulation to be run with HDL COSIM. COSIMulation is supported by Mentor Graphics ModelSim, so I have ModelSim installed on my machine. And to access that, I just need to double-click on my subnetwork, and in the model dialog pull-down, there is now a new model associated with this symbol that's called HDL Code Generator. Add data flow models, and if I select that model, the model interface changes to show you the Mentor ModelSim co-simulation interface. And here I can select different parameters of the design, but by default I can go ahead and just click OK and run the simulation. And here you can see in the simulation server that it's using ModelSim to compile the HDL, and it will then run a streaming co-simulation between SystemVue and ModelSim. Now, in the case of this particular design, ModelSim is being run with the graphical user interface being turned off, and the simulation runs very fast. I also have the option, if I want to debug my HDL code in ModelSim, I can come back to the part dialog for the subnetwork, and under the second tab, HDL settings, I can select Display HDL Simulator GUI. And now when I click Simulate, it'll bring open the ModelSim graphical user interface where we can actually see the simulation run inside of ModelSim. So right now, SystemVue is setting up ModelSim, and now it started ModelSim. That should be coming up here in a second. And here's the ModelSim UI, and you can see it compiled and loaded the model. And now at this point, since I have the GUI running, both simulators are paused, and to run the simulation to completion, I just need to type a command into the vSim command window, and I'll just type in run minus all, which will run the simulation to completion. And now you can see that the ModelSim waveform viewer has updated with the data from the run, and I can come in here and use ModelSim as a debug console if I needed to debug my VHDL code. And if I just go ahead and icon that, again, you can see that the frequency response and impulse response was run correctly. So again, in this video, just to summarize, since we covered quite a few things, we looked at converting the floating point FIR filter design by using the filter designer graphical user interface to convert the floating point FIR to fixed point FIR. We then ran a fixed point simulation using SystemVue's native fixed point simulator to show the fixed point response of the FIR filter. We then generated VHDL for this design using SystemVue, and then verify that the HDL in fact gives us the right response by enabling HDL co-simulation from within the SystemVue user interface. I hope this video tutorial was helpful, and I hope you enjoy using SystemVue, and please see some of the other tutorial videos that we have for helping you with other tasks using Agilent SystemVue.